What is this? Electric boogie woogie woogie. Hey everybody, my name is Sam and welcome back to Sam Craft. In today's video, we will be saying goodbye to Mr. 4 Foot the Power Strip. Okay, at least temporarily, because today's video is all about retrofitting my walls, which have already been insulated and completely finished, adding outlets in those walls, and otherwise juicing up the Sam Craft Workshop.
Anywhere close.
Roar!
Yes! Woohoo! Oh, overshot it. I was hitting the bottom of the wall. Awesome! It actually worked. Well, that was successful. It took a little bit of finagling, a lot of back and forth, but I finally got the wire, honestly, beyond the box and all the way down to the bottom of the wall, and that's finally what I was hitting in the end. This is one of the lowest outlets that I plan on installing, so that's gonna be one of the longest wires I have to fish through the wall, and if I can do that, I can do the rest of these. I tried to drill a hole through the top plate of my wall first to make sure everything was totally hidden, but there was not going to be any clearance there, and that also brought up the issue of, well, okay, when I insulate my ceiling and do my ceiling covering, what am I going to do at that point? So this is what I came up with. What I have in my hand is what's known as a handy box, or just basically a plastic junction box. I have a knockout punched out of the back here. This is going to be going to the wall, and the Romex is going to stick through this part. And then it has two knockouts, left and right. This is going to be my circuit, which is probably going to be the flexible conduit wire that I have. It's going to be running in, be able to junction, go towards the outlet, and then keep on going left or right, whichever way it goes. This is my solution for how I'm having to do my electrical very unique, since I've already closed up my walls and insulated it. And this is the best thing I can come up with that prevents me from having to run a whole bunch of conduit, have a lot of exposed tubes and things on my walls, and give me the cleanest installation in the end. As I'm going along the workshop here, adding my new junction boxes at the top of my wall, I am being very careful to drill the hole to fish the wire exactly 7 inches down from the top. That's going to allow me to make sure that all my boxes are the same height, and when I add my conduit wires connecting the boxes, it should be perfectly level and look as clean in the end. The reason I chose 7 inches is so that I knew I was well below the top plate, any kind of blocking I had put in place, yet still give myself plenty of room to add things, or if I ever wanted to, convert one of these junction boxes into a wall light, or an outlet, or something of the sort. It's also going to be well out of the way of any kind of storage lofts I build up here in my ceiling, and give me room to still insulate, finish cover the ceiling, and do whatever I want there as well. For this wiring project, I'm going to be running a combination of two different wire styles. I have some standard 12-2 Romex wire. This is what gets pulled inside of walls. But you're also going to see me use a product called ArmorLite 12-2 wire, and that's already contained within a flexible aluminum conduit. The reason I'm choosing to do two different wire types is because this is basically a retrofit. I have finished walls. They are insulated. They are sheathed with 1/2 inch or 7/16 inch OSB, painted and closed up. While the Romex is designed to be installed inside of wall cavities like you normally see with traditional wiring situations, you're not supposed to leave this exposed out in the space or put it inside of conduit. So what I'm doing here is using some Romex that I already had on hand for my inside the wall portions, and then I'm using a roll of ArmorLite for the exterior portions running from my junction boxes and on over around into my load center or breaker box. Obviously, if this was not a retrofit, if I still have my wall studs exposed, I would just be using Romex. It would be a lot easier installation, a lot simpler, less components, less things, but I'm doing it a little bit differently, as I tend to always do, and I'm doing more of a retrofit job, therefore having two different wire styles and this unique style shop wiring.
So the outlets I'm using for this whole project are Leviton Plus outlets. These are 15 amp, 125 volt rated standard receptacle or outlets. And they are really nice because they are side wire. To wire up them, you don't have to twist and your little hooks into your wires. You literally just strip them off, keep them straight, and these lugs here on the side have brackets and everything to clamp the wire in place. That makes installation a lot easier, a lot more simple, and any kind of steps you can save in the end really makes for a more enjoyable process overall. I also like these outlets because they're built pretty tough. They have metal bracket or metal plate that goes around the entire back of it. This little rivet you see here connects through to the front, right to where your plate cover attaches. There is a recessed nut right there, and that makes a super strong outlet. As far as where I get these outlets, I picked them up locally at Home Depot, but I'm sure other hardware stores should sell them. The Leviton brand is a Made in USA product, which is also another bonus, so you should be able to find it if you're in the US at least. So what I've done is went ahead and wired the two outlets together. However, they will not be this way in the box. Doing this saves me a lot of grunt work, whether I'm down in the floor, up on a laser workbench, or just wherever I might be installing the receptacles. Having these pre-wired makes my labor in the tight spots a lot easier. Now, whenever it comes time to wire this up to the box, I just simply cut the wires here in the middle, strip them off, and then attach them to my Wago lever lock nuts. While I'm not an electrician, one thing that I will say that is pretty important if you're doing this yourself, you might be tempted to wire them together and then just bring some wires off here and connect this into your junction box. You don't want to do that because what you're effectively doing is forcing this one outlet to carry the load of both of them. If there's a problem with the outlet or if you push your limits on your amperage, you could have issues there. So what I like to do is cut them in the middle, have them all kind of pigtailed out. I think the term is pigtails. Have the wire sticking out and they all get connected individually. That way, this outlet is only carrying its loads, and this one is carrying its loads, and they all get connected here, back to the main wiring in the wall. So here's a look at the final product. I have my outlets connected to each other, attached with the Wago lever lock nuts, and everything positioned where it should be. Pretty easy just to connect in the wires from the wall and then push it all in the box. Again, this is just a time saver, a sanity saver, and something that is easy to do ahead of time. I did most all of the wall outlets over here just like this, and I'm doing the last one here before I actually even cut the box or run the wires in the wall. So the more work you can do in a comfortable position, the better it usually will be for you. I have pulled my wire over here to my breaker box again, and I've turned off the power. Again, no power here. The Blue Eddy battery pack is what's running the lights in here. So I'm safe to work in here. Just want to say that. I'm working on taking the metal flexible conduit apart on this Armalite cable, and this is the part that I don't like. One, your hands will get dark gray from all the metal, just kind of rubbing up against aluminum. But then this part, as far as unwrapping to expose the wires, can get tricky. You gotta be careful you don't cut your hands open. So that's why I have a pair of pliers here. My wire strippers are gripping it. But then you've also gotta be careful as you're working around and around, you'll make that aluminum basically break out of fatigue and pop yourself in the head, theoretically, if you're not careful. So every once in a while, I kind of move the grip on the pliers, move it up, and then sometimes I'll also just twist it and break it off or just cut it with my wire cutters. You're left with a really nasty, jagged aluminum piece of death. Goes straight in the trash can or recycling bin if that's your style. Otherwise, I have to strip all of this back to this point where it's going to enter the box so I have my wires to run exactly where they need to. Well, guys, it feels amazing, and it pretty much looks amazing to have all of those outlets in the walls, totally, pretty much hidden, no major conduit runs going all around the outlets, and most importantly, to have all sorts of outlets for me to plug up all the various electronics, tools, equipment, and things in my workshop. No doubt the most exciting area for the outlets is LaserTown. It is so nice to have the Jiwit Cloud Pro CO2 laser, its duct fan and everything plugged up in its corner. Here in the middle, below the TV, I can have my computer, the TV, the X-Tool, other things plugged up right there. And then over to the right, I have room for the Atomstack M4 and Autor Laser Master 2 Pro diode laser to live and plug up as well. It is very, very nice. Tracing the electrical run from the sub panel or breaker box up the wall behind my electric heater, across, above, and on around the workshop, I gotta say, I'm pretty happy with how that looks. I knew going into this project that I would have some portion, or if not all of it, exposed, visible, and on the outside of the wall. So the fact that I have the armor light cable plus the junction boxes up around the top of the workshop, honestly, doesn't look bad. If anything, it actually looks pretty cool. It gives it an industrial look, and the fact that my boxes are exactly the same height and the wires are perfectly level helps to make it visually pleasing as well. Spinning you guys on around here, because you may be wondering, here is the other side of the workshop, the unfinished side. You have the sanding station and everything that I built several months back. And then, of course, there's this giant shelf of madness, chaos, and junkiness. At least that's what it looks like. Obviously, I did not wire up this side of the shop because I'm not ready to tear it all apart, to finish it out, and to do it so that it matches. So, of course, I have some work to do in the future. But for now, the majority of the shop is wired up, and that feels great. I don't yet have all of my workshop lights on a dedicated electrical circuit. And that's because over there next to the door, behind the shelf of chaos, is where the light switches will go. I will address all of that when I finally work my way around to that part of the shop to clean it up, get it out of the way, and button everything up over there. I've also been contemplating adding a window in that area because windows are kind of nice and I don't have any. So that means that whole area is going to be changing, fluctuating, and there's more stuff to do over there. But that's for another day. I have completed this part of the project. It is wonderful. Everything checks out. And like I've already said probably too many times, I'm really excited to have all the outlets I do now. If you guys got any questions or comments, leave them for me down below. Otherwise, take care, and I'll see you guys next time in the workshop.